Hello, everybody. It is 10:01 p.m. Central Time on Thursday, the 2nd of March, 2017. Welcome into the Earthquake 3D live stream, where we daily recap seismic events from around the planet. And as you may or may not know, we also issue daily and semi-daily earthquake forecasts for new areas to watch for movement. And it looks like we're starting out with about 675 people in the combined rooms between YouTube and Twitch and Facebook and Twitter and my website and everywhere where everybody's watching. Good to see you guys. Good to see you. Again, welcome in. So let's get into what struck since yesterday. And it's pretty interesting to see the areas that moved last night. Now, we have to actually go back 9 days. We have to go back 9 days before I even get into the areas that struck and talk about the deep earthquake that happened here, a magnitude 6.5, where our letter D is. And this location was struck about 550 kilometers down below South America 9 days ago. I issued a 7 to 10 day watch for this location to be on watch for up to a 7.5, possibly even higher, possibly two magnitudes higher than the 6.5. So that goes anywhere between 7.5 and 8.5. Well, since then, we've seen 5.0 strike in South America, but that's it. And over the past 2 days, take a look at what's hit in South America, 48 hours. See anything? How about over 3 days? One earthquake? 4.0? Something highly abnormal is going on right now down in South America. Silence across the entire continent. Now, normally, we would normally see across the entire continent in 3 days' time, we would see multiple 4 and 5.0 earthquakes, maybe even a 6. But nothing. Now, longtime viewers, you already know what this means, but new viewers, let me explain this. Anytime you see silence in an area where it's normally earthquake prone, even a professional will tell you this, you normally would want to see multiple smaller earthquakes in the 4 and 5 range strike across a region. Because when there's not, there's a lock, there's a building up of pressure, and it's the sign of a coming larger earthquake. Usually. Now, there are the rare times that it doesn't. But in the past, we've seen this happen over and over again in areas this size and bigger. We've even seen the whole Pacific plate go quiet for a day. And then the next day followed up with major movement. So, in other words, it stores up the energy and it builds up. This has been 3 days in South America. So just understand, South America has not been struck. And tomorrow, it's already starting to go into day 10 for the warning area. So day 10, still nothing, and we've gone silent for 3 days. So I am watching this area very close, and if it doesn't strike by tomorrow night, I'm going to have to reassess the warning, take it down to a watch, and figure out what's going on here. How much longer do we have to go? But I'm very concerned. Very concerned. This is with our global feed. So we're using the USGS, EMSC, just multiple agencies, geophone, and not one earthquake, not even above 4.0 being reported. Now, speaking of earthquakes above 4.0, let's talk about what happened over here in the West Pacific since last night. Now, you're going to see a few earthquakes marked down here in New Zealand that I think are worthy of making note of. First of all, down here at the plate boundary again, a 4.3, and the north part of the island, a 4.5. This is a full 2 to 3 magnitudes less than what we're looking for. Also, I'd like to point out that, 7 days ago today, 7 days ago, 1 week, so exactly 1 week ago, these deep earthquakes struck here at the letter D, and it prompted us to issue a warning for 1 to 2 magnitudes larger than the earthquake you see marked here. So it's a 6.9, one magnitude larger is a 7.9. Two magnitude larger is an 8.9. And let's take a look at the earthquakes that struck over the past day. Do you see anything around the letter D? Obviously, no. Nothing. Nothing of significant size has developed out next to our big, deep earthquake. Instead, something else, rather phenomenal has occurred. The entire planet moved out from that location, and you can see it stopped at the United States, just here northwest of the border of Washington State. You can see it goes all the way over towards Europe, and it even spread all the way down to our X mark down in Africa, and our X marks down here south of South America. But no large earthquake activity at all. All in the 5.0 range with one single 6.0 up here in Japan. There it is. 1.6. Now, normally in a week's time, there's 3 6.0s just by average. 2 to 3 6.0s happen a week. Well, there's one. I also understand we're under a period of high solar wind. High solar wind also means that there's an earthquake threat. But we aren't seeing any large earthquakes, which is troubling to me. Normally, you would want to see sixes over the course of a week strike. That's normal, according to the USGS, sixes over the course of a week. And if we only see one and there's normally three, we are far below average considering the deep earthquakes that occurred. So the deep earthquakes over here, we still have 2 to 3 days left to go in the watch time for this location. We said 7 to 10 days for this letter D as well. So we're on day 9, nothing's hit in South America, and it's gone completely quiet for our one big earthquake location. The other big earthquake location has also gone quiet all the way around it, with just a few fours down to the south. This is troubling to me. This to me says that we might be looking at, again, right on the last day, seeing the strike, just like it happened last time, at Christmas. Right at Christmas, we have to go back 7 to 10 days before Christmas, and we had two different events occur. Deep earthquakes leading to shallower, larger earthquakes back in December. Now here we are again. Is it going to be an exact repeat? That being said, take a look at this. Japan was struck. Japan was struck right at Kyushu with a 5.1 to 5.3 type earthquake. So what does that mean? Well, you can check Kyushu off the list because that was part of the warning 7 days ago. Here we are on day 7, and it was finally hit, just to check that one off the list. Now, for my people over in Europe, I want to show you something that happened today that's good news for the people in Italy and in Greece and in Western Turkey, but it's bad news for the people over in Eastern Turkey. Take a look at the swarm that developed out today over in Eastern Turkey, topping out near 5.6, 5.7. When this swarm occurred, guess what died out? The earthquakes here at Western Turkey and in Central Italy, with just a few striking throughout the day today, a few twos. Now, this is a noteworthy decrease in activity across Western Turkey at the peninsula and over in Italy, while it's a major increase over to the east. Now, this is the 5.0 earthquake that I was telling you to watch for in Iran. Iran, a 100% strike. What happened here, and I really think I've got a good idea of why the earthquake strike just struck just to the west of Iran, we have to go back a day to when this 5.0 earthquake struck out over here to the east. You see it marked in a darker red. This 5.3 to 5.4 earthquake, some agencies reporting 5.7, it's starting to make sense that it was probably more like a 5.7 that struck there. That 5.7 pushed the pressure, the whole amount, right out of Iran, right across the border into eastern Turkey. This is Iran, where our two red arrows are, right here in the middle. And Turkey's border is right here. So I got it off by just a little bit, so I'm going to call that an earthquake forecast strike, but the magnitude is spot on. There it is, 5.5 to 5.6, one agency reporting 5.4. So the 5.7 went down to a 5.5. Does that make sense? The red earthquake, 5.7, the lighter earthquake, 5.5. As the pressure transfers to the west, it loses a little bit of steam. As that's robbed the pressure from Turkey and robbed the pressure from Italy, people in Italy should be happy to some extent that this is a new blockage point. What's happening here is this is the plate boundary. You see where our red arrows are? Now look where the earthquakes occurred. Right along the side of our red arrow, the whole interior portion of the red arrows have been getting hit over and over again. This is the plate boundary. So a new fracture point has occurred here, which is relieving pressure off of the old fracture point that had happened here and the previous fracture point before that, which was here in central Italy. So we have three fracture points at this point across South Europe. This is basically, well, I guess I'm going to have to say this is a new spot that's going to do away with the pressure from Italy for a fair amount of time. So, if you live in Italy, the top earthquakes you're going to have to watch for are the leftovers off this 5. And it's going to hit a few places first. So when the pressure comes out of here, again where our new swarm is, it's going to first travel over to the west. And it's going to hit our second swarm location here at the peninsula, and western Turkey. Then the pressure is going to go two ways. It's going to go up to the north, following our red line around Romania, and it's going to follow the red line around Crete and go up into Italy. So your pressure is going to be halved in half again. So if there's a 5.5 coming in, it's going to be cut in half into two 4.8s. That's going to be cut in half again and equal about two 4s, 4.2 4.4s. So we have to watch out now for two 4.4s, one to be striking back in Italy up to 4.4, and one to be striking over in Romania now that this hit. That may also include Turkey here. Okay? It's getting a little confusing, but let me sum it up one more time. These suckers right here, this big stack, has stepped in the way, and it is now blocking the flow. And as long as it blocks the flow, you're going to see a decrease in earthquake activity at central Italy and an increase in earthquake activity down to the south along the red plate boundary, also over to the east along the red plate boundary going through Romania. It's going to then go out to the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, which is exactly what happened today, and this wraps it up for the European forecast or the European update, which is another 5 struck south of Iceland, right near our letter X. Well, gee, why did a 5 strike there? Oh, I don't know. How about a 5 over here? So 5s strike in succession of one another, and it's happened over and over again over this past week. Take a look at the 5.0s and greater, and you can see it. Color-coded let us know that the oldest one here, the more rare one, followed the 5 over here in red. So red, red, and then a pinkish color, pinkish red, and then a white and a white, letting us know it's happened 3 times this week. Do you follow me? And it's going to happen again, and the new split point is back here in eastern Turkey. So eastern Turkey is now the new spot to watch for larger movement to strike. And when I say larger, it could go larger if we see our large earthquake strike in the next 2 to 3 days. If we see these big quakes develop over here, the ones we're looking for, it's going to dramatically re-excite things for the entire West Pacific and the entire Pacific overall. Now let's get into the United States. Word has come to me that officials have now canceled the slow slip story, and that professionals have said the slow slip has suddenly stopped. That's the professionals now have weighed in on it. Apparently somebody got a hold of somebody and somebody talked to somebody about this, because now they've addressed it and said that the slow slip event that they thought was occurring has now ceased. Well, gee. Well, same time they say that that has now stopped, we saw a new 4.0 earthquake strike right here at Eureka, California, the spot where we told you to watch last night, and another near 4.0 earthquake, 3.6, striking off the coast of Vancouver, BC, on both sides of the zone we were talking about a slow slip occurring. So on both sides of the zone where the slow slip is occurring, we see near 4.0 earthquakes, and then the professionals come out and tell us that the slow slip event has suddenly stopped. I would say they're just not showing us the earthquakes in between these two zones. It's obvious. Do you guys, here, let me ask you guys. You guys are logical-minded people. I know a lot of you are very analytical. You're into earthquakes. I mean, that says a lot, right? So let me ask you, do you really believe all of Oregon, all of Washington State, and everywhere off the coast hasn't even seen one 0.0 earthquake in the last several months? When they're talking about a slow slip event just ending? Or are they not reporting to us 0.0 and greater earthquakes? Because I'm going to go turn on the USGS 0.0 and greater earthquake feed for today. And we've already looked every other day for the last week. And what you're going to notice here, guys, nothing off the coast. Oh, sure, now they've got a few 1.6s reported in Oregon today. But what do you want to bet that they're probably quarry blasts or explosions? Oh, yeah, here, take a look at the screen. Hold on. Here, let's go look up our earthquakes and see what it is. Oh, yeah, that's right. Oh, okay, of course. Of course. An explosion. Hey, how did I know there would be an explosion there? Am I just good at forecasting explosions? Here's another one. They'll mark there's an explosion by tomorrow. Negative 0.1 kilometer depth. Yeah. Same size. Here, let's go check this 1.2 up to the north. I wonder what that is. Oh, a Mount Hood earthquake. Well, I'll be. They actually have one on there. But nothing off the coast. So I'm getting suspicious that we're not being shown the earthquakes off the coast, and we need to see them so that we can understand when the slow slip event is happening to begin with and when the slow slip event is ending. I don't like taking anybody's word for it. I shouldn't As a scientist, I shouldn't have to take anybody's word for it. I should be able to see it. How can a professional say the slow slip event is ending when there's no earthquakes out there marked by the USGS? I'm just curious. I mean, really. So, that being said, I'm looking over the next couple of weeks if, let's just play devil's advocate. Let's say that did just suddenly stop. Well, what did I tell you? I told you that, well, actually, it's not even me. What did the Japanese scientist in the documentary the other night tell you guys? You know, the one from NHK and Smithsonian? What did they tell you? They told you that when slow slip events stop, it leads to a larger earthquake, like what happened in 2012 here in the same area. October 27, 2012, the 7.7 hit right after the slow slip event stopped. Or back in March of 2011, when the slow slip event was happening off the coast of Japan. And then it was followed up with the 8.9 earthquake. I mean, that was the whole point of the documentary we watched. So if they are saying that it has now suddenly stopped, I have to tell you, as a prudent observer of these things, that you guys need to be prepared in this region for up to a 7.7 earthquake. Now, why 7.7? That's the last sized earthquake that struck with a slow slip event in the Northwest back on October 27, 2012. Now, time frame on that, according to the professionals, it only takes a week to 2 weeks after the end of the slow slip event. So if the slow slip event just suddenly stopped last night, which I don't believe it did, but let's just go with what they're saying. Do you really believe the slow slip event just died out last night? Come on. They got wind. Somebody sent them the video they were watching or whatever, and they had to come up with a creative story. You know, story time. Story time from the professionals. It's like some new YouTube channel. Okay, so anyways, everywhere else, the warning signs are there that we're looking for approximately up to a 5.1 to be striking here in the Northwest. Well, already we have a 3.9 and a 3.7 up to the north. You add those two together, that takes us to 4. I'm looking for a 5.1, and the reason I'm looking for a 5.1 is because of all the other 5s and 5.1s that struck around the plate over the last week. And it stopped, here, let me show it to you one more time. It stopped just north of our border. So here's the last week, here's 5.0 and greater. Stopped just north of the border. It's pretty obvious. You can connect the dots from New Zealand across to the west, up through Japan, over across Alaska, and bringing us right down into our warned location, where the slow slip event has suddenly stopped. And then we get further down to the south, and we pick back up with 5.1 earthquakes, all 5.1s, and a couple 5.3s, which were upgraded from 5.1. I mean, pretty much everywhere I'm looking, I'm seeing 5 and 5.1 on the whole planet, except for just a couple areas. And those couple areas are the ones that are going to get hit next. It's just basic, simple logic. A flow of motion across the plates from a certain direction to a certain direction. Goes from one place, goes to the other. Starts over here in the West Pacific, goes all the way over, ends up over here on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. If you live in the United States, let me explain to you what's going on right now. You're going to be able to see, again, threes spread all the way across the entire West Coast. And this starts up at the Vancouver area, goes down to Eureka, 3.8, and then down south of California, just south of the border. Now, this is compensation movement for what happened over the past several days. Take a look up to the Northwest and just get a good look at what happened. All the movement, the major movement, happened up here. The pressure then transferred down the coast, as expected, and flared things up across California, as expected. We warned San Francisco, we warned Salton Sea. Those were the only two spots to get hit inside of continental United States. So the rest struck right offshore or right up to the Northwest. Then in the Midwest, the only other two locations we warned, one was hit again today. The fracking operations, again of Oklahoma in the Western Panhandle, struck again today, this time by a 3.3. You notice, guys, it's increasing. The magnitudes are increasing. Now, why are the magnitudes suddenly increasing in Oklahoma? When I show you this area, you guys will be able to see it. Take a look at it. See all these little square pads? Every single square pad is a different pumping operation. So oil and gas, and I'm not against oil and gas. I understand we need it, but there's a way to reduce the pressure in these wells without causing any damage, without causing any loss of money or anything to the oil companies. It's an invention I've come up with. I'd be willing to sell to them for cheap or even give it to them to reduce the earthquake threat at all of these wells. And there are so many of them. There's tens of thousands just in Oklahoma. And we get outside of Oklahoma, we're numbering in the millions, going all the way from Wyoming all the way over to the East Coast. And I'm not exaggerating, millions of drill points across the edge of the plate. And are you shocked now to find out that where they've drilled, it is now a weak spot in the crust? And when pressure is introduced on the West Coast, it reflares things back up in the Midwest. So there it is. You can check the Midwest off the list. These are the earthquakes we were looking for. This is the last 7 days. It is so obvious now that even a child can see it. The West Coast, heavy. Everybody knows. West Coast, heavy movement. Then moderate movement in the Midwest. You're pushing on the edge of something, and the middle portion moves too with the rest of the plate. Then just a little movement all the way over on the East Coast. Whatever leftovers come off the Midwest, they travel over to the East Coast. So the bigger the movement on the West Coast, guys, it's the bigger the movement in the Midwest. So if you live in the Midwest, you gotta look to the Northwest and West Coast to know what's coming your way over the next several days. And since we're looking for a new 5.1 to strike out here, it means there's going to be another swarm of earthquakes equal in size to what we're seeing now, and it's gonna kick back up over the next several days, pretty much in the same location, but this time, up to the northwest of this point just a little bit. So we're kind of going back into Kansas, maybe even into Colorado. You can already see over the past week, take a look at where, like, the progression of the earthquakes across the region. See? It started over to the east with the 3.1, and it's moved now to the most recent earthquakes far over to the west. And I would think that it's probably going to keep going to the west-northwest just a little bit and carry us up into Kansas. Of course, southern Colorado is also littered with fracking operations going into New Mexico. And then Texas, everybody knows Texas, is normally a lot of oil wells. Nobody's shocked by the oil fields in Texas. So that's just a breakdown of what we're looking for. We're looking for a 5.1 to strike the northwest. If it goes a little smaller, so be it. Should strike within the next... let's get a date on this. Today's the 2nd going into the 3rd. Should strike by the 5th going into the 6th. So Sunday into Monday. Okay, probably by Sunday. And why? Because it's on our doorstep already. The 5s have reached all the way down and have stopped just short of the U.S. Okay? So over in the West Pacific, let's recap one more time. This deep earthquake that occurred 7 days ago here at our letter D, we are looking for a shallower, larger earthquake. And it's most likely going to be striking next to our letter D to the west, the bigger of the two. And there's going to be two. There should also be movement down in New Zealand, but it should only be up to one magnitude larger than the 6.9. So if I'm wrong on this, I will come back and tell you, of course, so far we have not seen the follow-up movement we would expect to see off those deep earthquakes. That's all I can tell you. Since then, we've seen two new deep earthquakes raised high off the globe, and those are going to have their own results, which my viewers already know about. If you're a new viewer, let me just quickly tell you, these other deep earthquakes, the ones you see here raised high off the globe, they're only in the 4 range. But 4.0 earthquakes can cause shallow 5s to shallow 6s next to where they occur. So if you see, of course, the letter D here, you would look next to this for a 5.6 to 6.6 to strike within 72 hours of the deep earthquake. Same with this deep earthquake over here. You would look next to this spot for a 5.6 to 6.6. Depending on what size this is, it may be a 4.3, in which case it would be a 5.3 to 6.3, striking next to this location. Okay? It's just simple. It's so simple. Deep earthquakes cause shallower, larger earthquakes in the nearby silent zones next to the deep earthquake. The bigger the deep earthquake, the bigger the threat is for a large, shallow earthquake, like what we saw in 2011 in Japan. Another example, there was a flurry of deep earthquakes before that, a swarm of 5s, a 7.2 on March 9th, and then Japan got hit on March 11th with the big one. And that could easily repeat itself. We are here on the cusp of it. If it doesn't strike in the next couple days, I will have egg all over my face, but that's fine. I'd rather have egg on my face and be wrong than have the big one hit when a big deep earthquake hits and me not warn you. Okay? So I'm trying to allay your fears on this. Even with a large earthquake in the 8.9 range, it's enough, just like the Japan earthquake, to cause large tsunamis. That's the main cause of death in many of these large earthquakes. Now, yes, there are building collapses, but the building collapses that occur tend to occur only in unreinforced stone masonry buildings. So if you live in a building like cinder block or brick or just concrete with no reinforcing rebar in it, and even if it has rebar in it, that you might want to consider having an exit plan from the building if you get hit by an earthquake above 6.0. In earthquakes below 6.0, you usually tend not to see much collapse, depending on the quality of the structure. And you can talk to the people over in Italy that the sixes and sevens that struck, that knocked down buildings. The fours and fives that strike, those cause cracks and cause an inconvenience and scare people. Right? And some minor landslides. If the earthquake's like in the 5.0 range, it can cause some minor landslides, but nothing major. So the higher we go, of course, the higher in magnitude we go, the more damage there is. But I want you guys to know, we will see this coming. And I see it coming. It's just a matter of why is it not here yet? If it takes a day longer, let's say I say it's 10 days, and it hits on day 11 or day 12, so be it. We'll be back on and warning for it. You guys will still know to watch for it. You'll say, ah, there it is. He was just a day off. So I'm trying to get it down as close as possible. I've been wrong by a few days before, and I've been totally wrong before. I mean, it happens. My accuracy is 80%, 80 to 85%, depending on who calculates it, okay? And that means 20% of the time, I'm completely missing an area or getting the magnitude wrong or location wrong by over 200 miles. I've set my own criteria on this. If I miss by a magnitude, I consider it a miss. So if I say, watch out for a 6 and a 5 hits, I'll tell you about it. I'll say, that's the earthquake we were looking for, but that is an earthquake forecast miss. I was looking for a 6, a 5 hit. I wonder why. And I go and look into it. Or if I forecast for a big earthquake and the big earthquake doesn't hit, that's only happened twice in 7 years. But if I forecast for a big earthquake and the big earthquake doesn't hit, or if I miss the location, I will tell you, just like back at Christmas. I got the location off by 600 miles. I got it down to the day, down to the magnitude, down to the general area in the West Pacific even. But I wanted to get it down to the country. And let me tell you where I was looking. I was looking for a 7.9 to strike here in eastern Indonesia, South Indonesia, just next to Krakatoa. And instead it struck here in Papua New Guinea. One arrow back. Looking for a 7.9 down to the day. It just hit. That was the last big earthquake we forecast for. That was right around the Christmas time, right after the big one hit in South America. So if I get it wrong, I just want you to know I'll be back on and tell you. But I want you to warn the areas now. Let them know they only have a couple more days to go. So down in New Zealand is the area I'm really worried about because of the heavy populated centers around the region that if a 7.9 were to hit, then we're talking about major damage. Just plain and simple. Over to the west, if it hits, they got some populated islands, but if it strikes out to sea, it's not going to be causing a major tsunami at 7.9. But if I'm one magnitude low on this and it goes up to 8.9, we're talking Pacific-wide tsunami. We're talking Australia affected, New Zealand affected, Papua New Guinea and all the islands, Tonga, Fiji, all those. So it's a big deal for me to even talk about this. I hardly ever issue large earthquake warnings like this. You can talk to anybody in the chat room over on Twitch. They will tell you that I don't normally issue very large earthquake warnings. And when I do, I take it real serious. And if I miss it, it's total egg on my face and I feel terrible. So just understand that. And there's no money to be made in this. Go take a look at it, guys. I saw somebody just send me a whisper. Whatever. Okay? Or maybe you guys can't see that over to the right. Whatever. Whatever. Okay? Much love to everybody. So that's the update for tonight. It's only a half hour. That's what's going on. As for new areas to watch, I will have a new forecast out tomorrow. So tomorrow is the new 7-day forecast for the next 7 days. This pretty much fulfills every single area, except for the two large earthquakes, of course. Except for the two large earthquakes, every single area we were talking about has been hit. Let's take a look one more time. Take a look one more time. Even the coast of Vancouver, every single area. Down here at New Zealand, both sides of New Zealand. We warned both sides of New Zealand. Both sides of New Zealand hit from that last round. Now this new round, of course, it hasn't hit yet. But everywhere out across Europe, take it down one notch to fours, look. And you can tell, if you're in Italy, look, your pressure has been robbed. I don't hear you complaining. I don't hear you complaining that these guys came in and robbed you of your pressure, but you can tell which way it's going now. It's hitting in this area, and it's tending to go up and around, or down and around, and back out to the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. How long is that going to carry on for? I have no clue. All I can tell you is that if you're over in Turkey, you're now the go zone. So if you're in Turkey, you need to watch over to your east, big time. And if you start seeing earthquakes coming your way, you're going to release. You remember the big earthquake that hit in Turkey in 2011 into 2012? It was like a 7.0. Just take it back in time, just 6 years. It was a big one and thousands of people were killed. Thousands of people were injured. So let's not see a repeat of that. We'll know when it's coming. You'll see it coming a mile away. But I'm just letting you know that's going on right now. How many people are in here? 964 to 965? Okay, that is enough people. If you could, please share the information. Please subscribe if you're